Judith. The Lord has blessed thee by his power, who by thee hath brought our enemies to naught. Blessed art thou, O daughter, by the Lord, the Most High God, above all women upon the earth. Blessed be the Lord who made heaven and earth, because he hath so magnified thy name this day, that thy praise shall not depart out of the mouth of men, who shall be mindful of the power of the Lord for ever. For that thou hast not spared thy life by reason of the distress and tribulation of thy people, but hast prevented our ruin in the presence of our God. And from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary of Cleopas and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore had seen his mother and the disciple standing whom he loved, he saith to his mother, Woman, behold thy son. After that he saith to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour the disciple took her to his own. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The last time I celebrated Mass here at St. Cecilia's was a weekday, and the church was almost as full as this. So this parish has a great record of high Mass attendance, and it's just wonderful to see so many people here tonight. I thought that there'd be sufficient people with the program so I wouldn't need to read the, to repeat the readings in the vernacular, but I can see there are probably many people who are lacking a program tonight. What little faith we have in planning such a Mass as this. So God bless you for coming out tonight, and I want to thank Father Burns. Where is it? Here. Posing over there, humbly away, hiding there, for his warm welcome to me and to you this evening on behalf of Father Kerr running there, of course, who's unable to be here. And, well, it's always interesting celebrating the extraordinary form in an unfamiliar environment, as some of you will see. We're facing what some of you might find an unusual position for the extraordinary form. But we are, I'm told, I am facing east, which is the correct way, and you're all facing the wrong way. And so what should normally happen, if you're in a basilica in Rome in the old days, what would happen is that at the Eucharistic prayer, the canon, consecration, you would all turn and face the rising sun. So I won't ask you to do that tonight. But that was the custom in the church. For example, St. Peter's Basilica, the altar faces down the nave and it faces east. But the people would, at that point, turn towards facing east as well. So just to make sure that you don't look too much at the priest tonight, I think that's the genius of the extraordinary form Mass, that it's you shouldn't really focus at all on the celebrant, but on our Lord Jesus Christ, whose unworthy minister he is. I want to thank the servers for coming out tonight as well, and also for the scholar Cantus Angelorum for working hard in preparing the chant for tonight's Mass. I am quite sure that you will find it prayerful and uplifting. You will leave here tonight having felt that you really prayed the Mass. You were being raised in prayer and just allowed the liturgy of the Church to do its work. Liturgy is work of God. Let the liturgy do its work and allow yourself, as it were, to be worked upon by the sacred liturgy. Allow God to work in your hearts in this way. Today we have this beautiful occasion to celebrate this festal Mass of Our Lady of Sorrows. And again, I have to confess, it's a bit new for me as well. And you might find some differences between the Mass and the programme. And I should lay the blame entirely at the feet of the clergy for any differences you see, because we're trying to research exactly what should be in here. And my research and the research of some of my brother priests came a little bit too late for the programme. It's pretty much as it is, but as you notice, there were two extra collects today, and there will be two extra offertory prayers and two extra post-communion prayers as well, because we're required to commemorate both the Feria, the Friday of the fifth week of Passion of Lent, or Friday of Passion Week, also the saint today, St. John Damascene, so we've got those commemorations as well. And the last gospel today is not the gospel from John, as is customary at the end of the extraordinary form mass, but rather the gospel of the ferry. So just a few little changes there. But nevertheless, it is a wonderful thing to have this opportunity of celebrating this festal mass in honor of Our Lady of Sorrows, standing by the cross of her Son. Can the human heart refrain from partaking in her pain, in that mother's pain untold? Bruised, derided, cursed, defiled, she beheld her tender child, all with bloody scourges rent. We're very much aware in this Lenten season that we are preparing for a renewed commemoration of the suffering and death of our Blessed Lord upon the cross. Not a very pretty thing to bring to our imagination, but nevertheless a reality that we must not just celebrate once a year on Good Friday, commemorate once a year on Good Friday, but actually keep always before us. And the Mass is a repeated representation to us of the beautiful mysteries of the cross, of our Lord and Saviour shedding his blood for us and giving his body for us, and inviting us, of course, to do exactly the same in return to him. In the Mass this evening, when the priest repeats the words of our Lord, hoc est in corpus meum, this is my body. You know, we priests are supposed to take that to heart and say, this is my body which I offer to you, Lord, and for your people. And you, my dear brothers and sisters, can make the same sentiment your own tonight. When you see the Lord's body raised above the altar for your adoration and veneration tonight, even though the words in this Mass are said quietly, this is my body, this is my blood, in your hearts also say quietly, and I in turn want to offer you my body, my blood. In imitation of the sacrifice and the offering that your mother made, when she, by her fiat, that be it done to me according to your word, made an open offering of herself, which was totally without condition, without knowing precisely what that plan would entail. But when she, at the Annunciation, which we just celebrated a few days ago, heard the words of the angel Gabriel, how the power of the Most High would overshadow her, and that the one to be born of her would be great, and of his kingdom there would be no end, those words must surely have come to her mind when she stood at the foot of the cross. Do you think she was asking, well, what about that promise now? Or was she standing steadfast in faith, sure that the Lord would fulfill his promise? This King of the Jews who is crucified above me on the cross, his kingdom will last for her, and he will reign for her. Which of course means he will conquer death, he will rise again. But that security of faith does not prevent Our Lady from experiencing sorrow and pain. And, you know, when many of our catechumens will be celebrating baptism at the Easter Vigil, a wonderful occasion. But I hope the priest at the homily of the Easter Vigil, where baptisms are taking place, will not say, you know, life is going to be a smooth road from now on. It's going to be great from now on. You're going to be so happy, there will be no sorrows. That's not how it is it? When our Lord was baptized in the Jordan, he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted. In his humanity, the test began at that point. And through his life, he experienced sorrows as well. And Our Lady experienced sorrows, beginning with that prophecy from Simeon that a sword would pierce her heart. pain, that sorrow would accompany her throughout her pilgrimage of faith on this earth. And through those sorrows, and through witnessing the life of her son, her faith, strong as it always was, would be strengthened and deepened as she would become more and more aware of the mystery of her son's life. The same will be true of us in our lives of faith. We should always be so joyful, always have a deep peace that the world cannot give, but which our Lord the Saviour has promised us. The first gift that he gave when he rose from the dead, whenever he met his apostles and disciples, peace I give you. That peace is something that no one can take away, although we can let Satan disturb that peace. And if we fall into his hands, into a snare, then of course we will lose that peace. In the reading from the book of Judith that we read earlier, we read about Judith, a daughter of Israel, who infiltrated the camp of the Assyrians and got into company with Holofernes, the commander of the Assyrian army. And of course she deceived Holofernes. There was a banquet with him. And he drank much wine, got very drunk. And of course, in the tent at night, he lay himself down to sleep. And she was there in the tent also. He took a sword and beheaded Holofernes and presented the head to the people of Israel, to Uzziah, the king. And this reading that we had tonight is the wonderful hymn of praise that Uzziah offers to Judith because of the victory she had won over Holofernes, the Assyrian commander. "You've given your life, you did not spare your life," Uzziah said, because Judith had taken the risk of entering into that camp of the enemy. She could easily have been arrested there and then, and condemned to death. But the Lord was protecting them. This, of course, is a type of Mary. Judith is a type of the Mother of our Lord. Just as Judith was able to conquer Holofernes by decapitating him, and that doesn't sound very good. Well, do we not go back to the promise that God made our first parents in the Garden of Eden, in Paradise, when he said to the serpent that her head would be crushed by the offspring of the woman, or in older translations, by the woman herself. Ipsa contra, she will crush your head. Scholars actually say it should be he will crush your head, meaning the offspring of Eve, which of course is our Lord and Saviour, blessed Lord Jesus Christ. But yet Judith here is a type of Mary, who through Mary, the head of the serpent is crushed. And I know some of you have entered into the enemy camp of late. I was asked, you know, well, would you just say a few words about 40 Days for Life? And the next I knew was that this was being promoted as the 40 Days for Life concluding Mass. And many of you have entered into the camp of the enemy, bravely keeping vigil outside those places where Satan is very much at work, killing and enabling mothers to kill their children and making them think it's the right thing to do. At a place that is paradoxically called love joy. How can such a place have such a meaning when it does such terrible things? But you have been there praying, not exercising any kind of anger or anything like that, but being there praying. And I know you've experienced the wrath of Satan when you've been at that place. It's been uncomfortable for many of you. But you have borne witness, you have been martyrs in that situation. And I know that you have touched people's lives and have made mothers rethink options and have saved lives. And you might have saved future lives as well. Because you know, at these places, people sometimes say, you know, I was here before, but I saw you last time I came here, and I resolved not to do it again. Next time it will be different. So you don't know how you have touched people, how many lives you have saved. You've certainly been doing God's work, and you deserve every thanks from us, society. I'm sure many more of us would love to have been there if we did not have other conflicting duties. Maybe some of us are doing an examination saying, well, maybe I could have given that greater priority to be there at that time. But you have stood there, like our Blessed Mother, at the foot of the cross, seeing him suffering in those little ones, and indeed in the mothers who are suffering as well, and so often alone. When you ask a mother who sometimes, who has admitted or perhaps confessed to the sin of abortion, why did you do it? Or why did you allow it to be done? I was on my own. I had no one to turn to. And here we are, wanting to be there for those people so that they can turn to us and experience true love and the true joy of life. So let us today give thanks for all that work. And let us not give up hope either. We must remember, you know, that faith of our Blessed Mother when she heard that her son's reign would never end. We too must be utterly confident that the reign of our Lord Jesus Christ is assured. But we must be his warriors, if you like, we must be his companions in spreading his reign throughout this world. In the remaining week between now and the great commemoration of Good Friday, let's be very, very close to the one who is not only the mother of our Lord, but is our mother too. What a sorrow Mary experienced when she was given John as her son, when she saw her son, the real son, leaving on the cross. But Mary accepted John as her son, and accepting John, she accepted all of us as her children and became the mother of the church. And we too, of course, got a much greater deal, better deal, in receiving such a wonderful mother in our Blessed Mother, the Blessed Virgin Mary. Let us really, maybe in this next week, take Mary very much to heart, as John did. He took Mary into her home, the home of his heart. Let us, on this festal day, we are celebrating today, let us on this festal day also take Mary very much to our heart. And she will ensure that even though we must experience sorrows in this life, that sorrow will be turned to unending joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.